Hi, everybody. Welcome to Paul Listening Behind the Curtain. It's my opportunity to step away from the world of politics and law you watch me cover on television every day and do something maybe a little more fun, which is to talk about theater and the arts. And today we get to talk about one of the really great shows that had its start in Chicago before it went to Broadway. Successful here, successful there. So guess what? It's coming back around on its way into Chicago again. And that is Pretty Woman. If you never saw the show, you know the song. But the question is that song still in it? Let's find out. Let's dig into it. Joining me to talk all about Pretty Woman coming back to Chicago is Chase Wolfe, who plays Edward Lewis. That is indeed the lead. That's the Richard Gere character for the movie fans out there. And we're going to talk all about it. Chase, thank you for joining me. I know you've got a show coming up soon, so thank you.
No problem, Paul. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
We're going to also do a tip of the cap to your co-star, Ellie Baker, who has tried to join this conversation for the last many minutes. She plays Vivian Ward, also the star of the show. Unfortunately, where she is has horrendous connection. And so we have said, it's okay, get some popcorn. We're going to proceed. So you can feel free to mention her anytime you want in terms of bringing her up. But Chase, let me just start. I think most people, if they haven't even seen the musical, they certainly know the movie. But for those who aren't familiar, let me invite you to kind of give us the plot of what Pretty Woman's all about.
Yeah, absolutely. So Pretty Woman is kind of, it's the hybrid modern day child of the Cinderella story and Pygmalion My Fair Lady? Is that right? Yeah, My Fair Lady.
Pygmalion was My Fair Lady. That's right.
Yeah. So it's kind of the hybrid child of that. It's about a business tycoon and a girl from the streets that, like, fate has brought them together, and she really brings out the best in him and changes him for the better. And when he offers her what he thinks is enough, she says, no, that's not enough. I want the fairy tale. And so our show is really fun. It's all about never giving up on your dream. It's all about just this powerful, dynamic leading lady who, Ellie, who is not here, she does the role phenomenally. You will fall in love with her instantly. She never leaves the stage. She's just so, like, incredible and plays so such a good, like, homage to Julia Roberts, but also makes it her own. And so you're going to love the show. And we also have all this music by Bryan and Jim Vallance. So not only you get this classic story, but you're also getting some solid, like, 80s, 90s rock music that's just incredible.
Yeah, well, you give me some stuff I definitely want to follow up on. So yeah. let me first go by, first of all, you had mentioned that what Ellie does pays nice homage to Julia Roberts. And so, you know, I always think for an actor, there's two challenges. When you're playing a historical figure, that's mm-hmm. got to be a challenge because, oh, look, you're Harry Truman. Let's see how well he does, right? And then on the other hand, if you're playing a completely fictional figure, well, then you get to do what you want. But this is a hybrid mm-hmm. because it's a fictional figure, but most people say, I totally remember Richard Gere and Julia Roberts. So I'm curious as to what kind of challenge that is for you as actors, and you can speak for Ellie, in terms of saying, yeah, I get it. I realize I'm in a role that this iconic actor has played before, or do you not care? Is it your own?
No, you are so right. We get this question all the time, actually, especially because when you see this movie, they go, oh, that's the Julia Roberts, Richard Gere. Nobody knows my name is Edward Lewis in the show. They know they think I'm like the Richard Gere.
Might as well go by Richard Gere.
Yeah, that's all they know. So to have that kind of hanging over your head, it's a little bit daunting at first. I did watch the film a few times to try to get in what he does. And at the end of the day, though, like, the story can only be told through our lens because we are the actors. So I like to say we play homage to what they did and who the character they developed is, because this is a character we're taking from someone else, but I can only play that character through my lens. So I try to give a few, like, Richard Gere-isms in the process of the show. But mostly it is my telling. 'Cause as Ellie likes to say too, like, you would not enjoy her playing Julia Roberts playing Vivian. You want, like, because you fell in love with Vivian, who is a lot of who Julia Roberts is. And Ellie is also just playing Ellie as Vivian. And you're going to still get the same heart, the same passion, the same everything you fell in love with Vivian. It's just going to be a little bit of a different look for you. And same with my character. It's a little bit different. And they give me songs, so I get to express those little those close up, like, I love you shots where he just stares at her lovingly, because you can't see that on a stage. They gave me songs, so I get to sing about it.
Yeah, I just love it. And of course, you mentioned the music of all this. So let's talk about that. First of all, I kind of led with this sort of saying, but it's a song Pretty Woman in it, because And by the way, as I said, this show tried out in Chicago. So I do a TV end of this called Broadway Backstage. Mm-hmm. And so I sat with the cast and sat with everybody. So I got to ask them the first time around these questions, but lots of new people, I'm sure, watching this. Yeah. So the question is whether Bryan Adams and Jim Vallance, whether they would have said, look, we didn't write Pretty Woman. That's a Roy Orbison thing. So that doesn't belong here. Do you know? I mean, if not, I'll tell you. Do you know the history of whether that song was going to be in the show?
So I can tell you this right now. I know it never made it to Broadway, and by popular demand, it is in our show. And you have to wait to find out when it comes in. We tease it all show long, but it comes in at a very, very specific moment. But yeah, it was not in the original. It did not make it onto Broadway. And so many people said, "What? I went to the show and Pretty Woman wasn't in it. This is insane." And so when the tour kicked off, they paid the rights to the show, a song, and now it is in the show.
Yeah, that is such great news. And when I talked to Bryan Adams about this, I mean, look, I don't ever remember him saying, I refuse to have it. It was nothing like that. I mean, but he wrote, there's a whole score written for this show. And the music in this show, man, it is fabulous. This is really great stuff. And as you say, absolutely, it's reminiscent of what he's done in the past, because a lot of us know a lot of his music, but this is original. This is great.
It's original. It's fun. And you'll recognize it. You'll recognize it as Bryan Adams' music. And I think one of the cool things they did do in the show, so we don't have like the bathtub scene, but we reference that it is happening. And instead of singing a Prince song, she sings a Bryan Adams song. So we took that song out and put in kind of his music that he wrote that we all know and love. That's not from the show. That's truly just a Bryan Adams music. And so that's a really cute, fun moment. And like, you know, a tribute back to the guy that put blood, sweat, and tears into making this music so great.
And you know, Jerry Mitchell always begins his productions in Chicago for a whole host of reasons, not the least of which is that he began his career on stage in Chorus Line in Chicago. He just had Boop Here, Boop the Musical. And that that played here in the very theater where Jerry was on stage doing Chorus Line X number of years ago. So it's just really a special town for him. I'm sort of curious. I mean, I can watch any musical and say, that's Jerry. I see Jerry's imprint here. How much play at this point now, it's national tour time, you're beyond Broadway. How much of a role, if any, has Jerry played? Have you talked to him, met him? Is he watching you?
Absolutely. So he individually and personally hasn't been super involved with us because he's been working on Boop. He's currently working on Devil Wears Prada
up in London. And Elton John, he made Elton John write all these new songs for it.
Absolutely. And they've been working on this for a while. I remember like a couple of years ago, some of the workshops at Open Jar in New York, where they were testing some things out. Also, he opened the UK tour. Jerry went over there to make sure, because it's their first national UK tour. But DB Bonds is his associate, and he was there. And we have all of Jerry Mitchell's original choreography, all of his original blocking. I mean, the show is the work he did. His associate just learned it and adapted it and put onto us. And he's still, we know he's keeping tabs because he shares, actually today he just shared a TikTok we did just in the stairwell here in Detroit, and that was cute. And then if we get a really good review, he always posts it on his story. So he's keeping tabs on us. I know he's like watching, and he still has like love and passion for the show, but that man is busy and he is working, and we're so excited because it just means if we're doing this for him now, who knows where we'll be in the future.
One of the other great things about a Jerry show, because he also Kinky Boots started here in Chicago, right? And I mean, that's the Kinky Boots, like with Billy Porter, with, you know, that version, right at the beginning. It started so many careers. But the thing is, there's the music, there's the dance, there's everything that goes with him. But I think he really gets a sense of the visual and the scenery. So you're touring now. It's not this sit-down production. Are we getting, to your knowledge, the same sets, the same kind of gorgeous stuff that we had here before the show went on to Broadway?
You know, I'll be honest with you. I don't know what the set looked like in Chicago. I don't know what the set looked like in Broadway. But I do know that our set is gorgeous. It's stunning. It's colorful. It's full of lights. It is a more simple set than you are probably used to seeing in these big shows like Wicked or The Lion King or whatever. Like, but it really doesn't need to be a lot, because this story isn't about the set. It's about two people falling in love. And so really, like, the more simple the set, the better, because you really are just so focused on Vivian and Edward and what's going to happen next. And why are they, like, you know, are they going to kiss? Or are they not? Like, what, like, why is this tension, this like sexual tension there the whole time? And I think, you know, like it is beautiful and stunning, but at the end of the day, like, the story is what we're here to tell. And I think you will just get so enraptured in the story that the set is, you know, second best to us.
And of course, even some of the here, some of the ensemble, I shouldn't say ensemble, really, it is ensemble, but they're also sort of secondary star players. And at least in the first round through, there was an actor, you can let me know who it is now, who like played many roles. So he's always showing up and he's always in a different costume. And after a while, it works. I mean, it is funny, but it's intended to be. It just works. And you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah. So this is Adam Duplessis. He plays Happy Man, who, and if you've watched the film, if you're familiar with the film, Happy Man is all of 5 seconds of the film, and they've expanded him into this godfather of the show character that you're just going to love. He's all over. He's up, down, around. If you're not cheering and clapping for him by the end when his face just appears, you're crazy. And in the tour, he plays more characters than he did on Broadway. Some of the extra bit part characters that they let ensemble play on Broadway, they have actually given this man on tour. So he plays about 5 or 6 different characters, and he's flipping and shifting. He's also South African, so all of his accents are not his true accent. You never really hear his South African accent. So brilliant, brilliant actor, performer, even character actor. He's stunning. We also, Kit DeLuca is played by Ray Davenport. She's a Detroit local.
Who, by the way, in the Chicago and the original Broadway one was played by Orpha, who has one of the best Broadway voices in the world. Oh,
absolutely. No. And Ray Davenport is a former Six Queen, from the Norwegian ships. So her vocals are riffs stunning. I mean, she could throw down. She steals the show every time she walks on the stage.
Well, you were on the Norwegian Cruise Line too.
Yes, I was. I worked for Norwegian Cruise Line Holdings. I did that, Oceania and Regent. I kind of floated all the way through with the creative studios.
Literally.
Yeah, literally. I did Footloose 1.0 when we did that and kind of covered some people. So yeah, the cruise ships have been a huge part of my development and becoming the actor and performer that I am today.
Are they a good thing? You know, I've never talked to anybody really about the cruise ship experience. I know many people who have done it, but do you look and say, what a great preparation, if you will, for the work I'm going to do on touring or Broadway? Because now you're touring, but you're in a bus or a plane somewhere.
Yeah. I mean,
what is the cruise ship experience all about with all those changing audiences?
So it's hit or miss, depending on like what you do and where you do and why you do it. But at the end of the day, like, a lot of the reason I'm cast is because when you hear me sing, I'm not a Broadway voice. I'm somewhere mixed. Every pop artist says you're too Broadway for pop and you're too pop for Broadway. Hmm. It works in this because it's Adam Bryan's music in a Broadway show. So they want me to sound like some kind of rock artist. But also just to be able to switch vocals. So I'm here doing a rock show. Well, I've done big band shows. I've done Broadway cabarets. I've done the disco. I've done the R&B. I've done the pop. Like, you just have to learn and shift and move, and you're constantly performing for new people. You're constantly changing. You wake up every morning in a different country half the time. Like, so it really does teach you to just go with the punches. I relaunched a ship after the pandemic as well. Talk about some punches. We had also the war happened at the same time, so we had a moment where like our band was 3 people and it was supposed to be a 7-piece band. And so we're like, what are we doing? Are we doing tracks? Are we doing this? Well, we can't do a show at all, so we have to come up with a new cabaret. And just to be able to go on the fly on tour, you never know what's going to happen. You never know who's going to drop, who's going to come in. And I think ships trained me really, really well for that. And they're fun. I got to see the world and experience really cool things that most people don't get to experience. And I got paid to do it. So.
And you didn't mention how fabulous the food is.
Well, it is actually. So some ships, like the bigger ships, you're like, the food's fine. But I worked on Oceania and they are known for their food. And then Regent is their sister ship. So by default, I always say they get it like 2 years later. And it's really, really good. Like on Regent, I could have steak and lobster every night for free because it was all inclusive. And I was just, you know.
So pretty soon they're going, Cowboy Bob's putting on some weight up there.
I was in the gym constantly. So, and with Cowboy Bob, I was in Alaska. So I was doing some incredible hikes every day, just up and down the mountain constantly. So that was probably actually the best shape of my life.
I love it. And by the way, when you get to Chicago, forget the cruise food, because have you played Chicago before? Are you familiar with Chicago food?
No, my first time in Chicago was actually almost a year to the date we are coming into Chicago. I had never been, and I came in to see my friend was Tina and the Tina Turner. Back on it.
She was one of the two Tinas, right?
Yeah. So Ari Groover, she's actually back on tour now. I think she's taken kind of a month hiatus for a thing and then she'll be back, but she's still playing Tina. And she had like just gone in and she's like, I'm opening in Chicago. So I flew to Chicago to see her perform. Wow. And it's stunning. Yeah. Great show.
What'd you take you to eat? Where'd you go? I'm curious.
Oh my goodness. I had never done deep dish. So I had to do one of the Uno Duo Trio. It's like the same company, but
not Lumel, right? Uno or Duos, not Lumel Nani's.
No, I think we tried to do Illuminati's, but the line was too long or something. So we just,
well, make sure you do it this time. You are here for, well, it's only a week to March 12th to 17th. Not a lot of time, but just, you know, yeah. Text me, make sure. I'll make sure you're getting to some good places.
Yeah, send me to all the great places. I'm such a foodie, and I love coffee, and I love my alcohol at the end of the day, too. So I'm going to be, like, eating and drinking my way through Chicago
for sure. I'm a junk food guy, so you're a couple of blocks. You're at the CIBC Theater. I'm also saying this to plug where you're going to be, but you can just walk a couple of blocks up, and there's a place called Garrett's, which is cheese corn, caramel corn. We're famous for it. So.
Yeah, I've had Garrett's. I did the Garrett's. Okay. It was a must-do, and it's in the airport.
And her theater was right near it. But let's go back to Pretty Woman. Okay. So here's the other thing. The relationship between Edward and Vivian is really critical. In a movie, we can do a close-up, all sorts of ways that movie directors can make those relationships happen. Here, of course, you are given this surrounding cast of fabulous players that are with you, but we still need that relationship without the close-ups on camera. How did that develop? What did you do to get ready to sort of make that happen between you and Ellie, who, once again, for people tuning in late, tried to join us, connection problem. So I would ask her this too, but talk about how you develop that relationship knowing you've got to get that to the last aisle of the theater.
Yeah. I mean, I genuinely think Ellie and I have been like best friends almost from the beginning. We're best friends on and off the stage. We trust each other. So I don't think that was ever like an issue for us. We kind of just like jumped into it full throttle, became friends. And like, we have some really fun moments. We also are two actors that really like to, we're both very giving actors on stage, and eye contact is very important for us, and communicating, like, it's just very, and in fact, we got a note today saying, you guys are too familiar. Remember that you meet each other, not, because we're just like, we really do. The connection really is just genuine. And if you see us hanging out after, you'll be like, oh, they're great. But, and it translates, and we trust each other on stage fully. And we have fun with it. Every scene is new and different. We'll change the line a little bit different here to keep it fresh and to keep it new and keep it exciting. And I really do think that plays, and I think it shows, and we can hear it in the audience's responses. There's a bunch of call and response. There's a bunch of the cute moments, and we get the oohs and the ahs and oh, I know it's working because we're literally getting the responses from the audience.
And by the way, so how long have you been on this national tour?
This whole cast has been on since October 2nd of 23. So we all started October 2nd, and we'll be here till May 19th.
So it's 4 months that you've been doing this, because what I found intriguing, and maybe some of my viewers did or listeners, which is you just said, and I got a note just the other night that they said you're too familiar. So some would think that once you hit quote unquote opening night somewhere, you're on your own, but you're telling me, no, there's still somebody out there who's going, wait a minute, Jace, we got to talk.
Yeah, so we have, unlike a show that's stable, so in Chicago for a long run, you would have like DB Bonds, an associate director who is there the whole time watching after like someone like Jerry Mitchell leaves to do their next project. However, we don't have one on tour, so our stage manager keeps us in check every once in a while. So we just did DC, and DB came back to watch us and give us a few notes. Our music supervisor is coming to give us notes again this weekend. And then, we also have our conductor, our music director, who gives us vocal notes to make sure everyone's maintaining the integrity of the show. We want to make sure that what we gave you opening night is what we continue to give you as it morphs and changes and we make new decisions. Sometimes it evolves into something it really wasn't meant to be slowly, and no one realizes it. And so we have dance captains, we have music directors, and we have our stage manager kind of keeping us in check and saying, hey, reel it back in. Let's make sure we're still telling and being authentic to what Jerry Mitchell has said, to what DB Bonds has said, to what everyone has done to maintain the authenticity of what we created to start with.
You know, when people did a Sondheim show, I know several who work for him or with him, and oftentimes they would say if he was in the audience, they couldn't function. They just couldn't. I mean, he's there. If you were to be told one night, and I'm not, I mean, if Jerry Mitchell were watching you, would that be like a, oh, cool, or to be a, oh, no?
I'm a weird. I think Ellie would actually be like, oh, no, and she'd freak out and she wouldn't want to know that he's there. But I kind of tend to be one that's like, all right, bring it. You know, like, he hasn't seen us perform yet, and I'd love for him to. So I kind of am like,
let's call him right now. Let's get him out there.
Yeah, call him up. No, but I'm just like, yeah, like, great. He's here. Let's show him how it's done. Let's show him what we're doing with the show. And, you know, if he has notes after, great. Like, that's part of it. That's what we're used to. In fact, some of us are like, give us some notes, because I think I'm deviating a little bit. You know, if we do it right, he'll enjoy it. And it's really nice for me to have someone that knows the show so well, watch it and come back and say, I got lost in the story again. And I know this so well, but I got lost in the story again.
Yeah. You know, which is such a wonderful thing to say, because and the audience is getting lost in the story. Mm-hmm. Since this is your first time, you've been in Chicago, you've seen Tina here. She was amazing in that show. Yes. I got to interview her too at the time, but that was Out of curiosity, what did she tell you? What do you know about Chicago audiences? Because I could be wrong, but I think you're in for a different experience in Chicago than you might be having in Detroit or other cities, with all due respect to the other cities.
No problem at all. I actually I have no expectations for Chicago. I was in the audience in Chicago. I saw the love and support they gave for a show like Tina, where it is a jukebox musical. Everyone's familiar. They can sing along to everything. Ours is that, but in reverse. So whereas if you're watching Tina, you know the music, but you don't know the story. When you're watching our show, you know the story. You just don't know the music.
Right.
You know? Oh, and so we
comparison.
Yeah, so we get like the reverse of that, where we have people, I've heard people quote lines from the audience, just shout it out, and just and like half the time it makes us break a little bit too, because it's just funny when someone loves the story so much that they have every line quoted. And our script is, it's modified from the movie, but it's pretty much direct from the movie. We just made some things work for stage and change things, but most of every line, you know, you quote it, you know what's coming next, especially all the iconic lines, all the iconic moments, they are there.
Lin-Manuel Miranda said, he goes, when he would drop a line as Alexander Hamilton, he goes, the audience shouted it out to him.
Because they knew. Absolutely. Yeah.
You're in one of those.
Happen to us all the time when we're just like, oh, great. Or they'll laugh, or we'll get a laugh because they know the line, not because the line is funny, but because they recognize the line and they're like, oh, that's that moment from The Thing. I remember that.
I love it. Well, what you're in for in Chicago, now that you'll be on stage in front of them. Yes. And one of the reasons Gere and others love to try their shows out here is because I think you are going to find, this isn't me, but you're going to find that Chicago audiences are sophisticated. They know theater. They know what to like. They know what to expect. And the reason Gere would open shows here is because he learned so much from these audiences. New York is wonderful, but tourists and, you know, whatever. But that's not, we go to theater because we love theater and it's part of our living and breathing here.
Yes. Well, good. I'm excited. I want to hear what everyone has to say and hear them shout and not shout and give us notes. No, I'm just kidding. But no, I'm excited for like a theater audience, someone who genuinely just like loves and appreciates just the art as a whole. And hopefully we tell the story in a way that really connects with them and really touches them. And because that's why we do what we do. We're there to inspire people, to change people, to move people, to feel something no matter what. So hopefully the show is that for them.
And the downside to being here only March 12th through the 17th with a matinee or two thrown in there is you're not going to get much time to go play in this. And here's the thing. I would tell you it's going to snow, so stay home. But it's like summer today. I mean, you know, we know, call climate change, whatever you want to call it. But the bottom line is Chicago seems to have some pretty moderate winters now.
It happens. But I do think we're there for the Green River.
Oh, if you are here for St. Patrick's Day, the Saturday before, indeed, they turn the river green.
See, I'm excited. I'm colorblind, so I won't really be able to see it, but I'm excited.
In your case, they turn it blue, but you'll go, wait a minute, it looks like the regular river. Well, yeah, it's because you're colorblind.
No, we have this joke actually with the tour that because I'm colorblind, I just can't see things that are green and red. And so they're like, yeah, the river's gone, Chase. And I go, oh yeah, it's just a ditch.
I love it. Do you, are there cities, I mean, do you look forward, you've got this tour, you're going all over the place. Are there certain cities you say, I can't wait to go there, and certain cities you went, I'm not asking you to name anything, but are certain cities that excite you more than others?
Absolutely. I mean, having done cruise ships, I always tell people I've seen a lot of the world. I'm really excited to see my own country. And mm-hmm. So I'm going to all these different places, and whether big, small, whatever, like I go into a town expecting nothing, just to see. And some of them, I mean, even with cruise ship ports all over the world, you leave a port and you go, I was okay. I don't need to go back there. And other cities, you're like, I didn't get enough. I didn't get enough of this. I have to go back and see more. And I do genuinely believe, like, I spent like 4 days in Chicago, and Chicago is one of those cities that I will always love going back to Chicago. It's just beautiful. I love the food. I love how kind of walkable it is. Like, I love the above ground train. It's so beautiful coming in and out. And I've got some friends that live there from my Footloose contract on Norwegian. So I'll be staying out with her. Yeah, it's just like, I don't know. It's just one of those cities I really do thoroughly enjoy.
Well, I'm glad. That is good. Now, do you come in, do you have a tech rehearsal that you go through it, or pretty much at every city, the stage is set up for you and you're like, oh, we're back, next place, doesn't matter where I am.
Stage is set up. The crew starts loading in at 8 a.m. They are done. We have a cast meeting probably starting around 4:30 or 5. In every city. Only the first night. We come in, we do a cast meeting to know what the stage is going to be like. We have a sound check, and then we go. And it works. We carry our own Marley floor. So the stage, the flooring always looks the same. So as long as we can trust that, everything tends to be just fine and dandy.
And I mean, looking at your history or some of the shows you've done, I mean, you do a lot of, maybe not Xena Warrior. No, that was a musical too, actually. So, yeah. I mean, musicals are your thing. I mean, is there, do you sort of look and say, I want to, it's time to do some dramatic straight plays, whatever, or is musical who you are?
Yeah, I personally, because I love to sing so much and I emote through singing, musicals really are like more my passion. I haven't done as many straight shows, mainly because there's no straight plays on cruise ships. And I did a few back home, but musicals were just kind of like, it's just a path I kind of chose, and I've been in that path for a while. I'm open to straight plays. I'm also, if I'm fully honest with you, to audition for them, you have to memorize like monologues on monologues on monologues, and I'm too lazy to do it.
So you just need to learn the whole show.
Yeah, just give me like straight to the callback where I'm using the show material and I'm great. Like, let's just dry read and like do that act. Like, I love when you audition for a musical, they give you sides and they're like, come on, act to this scene. I love that. And then the director gives you notes and you change and you mold and you fix it. And like, it's so fun. I just don't want to come in with a monologue nobody cares about.
Yeah.
And that has nothing to do with the show. It's just proving that I can act, and I could have rehearsed it a million times, and that's the only good acting I can do because I'm just super familiar with this. I'd rather just give me the material and let me show you that like I can play with material rather than like I memorized something. Good job, you know.
Where'd you grow up?
I grew up in South Carolina, the upstate of South Carolina, a little Greenville Spartanburg area. If you're familiar with it, it's where the BMW plant is, got an Amazon plant. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm lectured there. You can go and vote this weekend if you want. that's what I cover in my other world. But here's the thing, because I know when you were there, just a little about you that you've done production work, here you play, Edward Lewis is, I mean, you're a rich business guy, you know, is that something, it's not really part of your mind knowledge. Is it sort of fun to sort of play a world that you didn't really grow up with, that I know?
I haven't played around with I'm not doing $1 billion contracts and stuff, but ironically enough, during rehearsals, I refinanced a home that I bought straight out of college, and I also won a little money from a game show called Don't Forget the Lyrics, and I fused that all together and bought another house in West Virginia cash to flip with my brother, and we're gonna also build another house from scratch. So I am kind of like a business
Edward Lewis-y. Well.
Yeah, I'm a little Edward Lewis-y. On ships, I was wearing peace suits. I actually auditioned the show on video, and then my ship happened to be docking in New York that I auditioned. The callbacks worked out that I snuck off the ship in my three-piece suit that I was wearing for work because they said dress like $1 billion. So I went to the audition. I came out of the audition, walked right back onto the ship, and started greeting people to change clothes at all. Just literally walked right back onto the ship. And so, yeah, it's, he's a little different in that I'm not like that high up in the business world, but I know a lot of the jargon.
The thing is, you call on that, right? I mean, an actor call on something in your background and say, this is going to help me understand Edward.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's a mode. I don't know if I actively do. I don't think I actually do it, but my family has noticed. They're like, yeah, when you're in certain scenes in business mode, you change. Like your voice changes, your posture changes. And then like when they called me out on that, I clocked it in the show and went, oh, I do this in real life. This is the mode I go into when it's time to do business, when it's time to make I just flip into, all right, we just got to be a hard ass right now and like get it going. And so, yeah, I connect with it a little bit more than you would expect.
I love it. Well, it's been kind of fun getting to know you a little bit. We didn't need Ellie.
No, thanks for...
We'll line her up. kidding, Ellie, if you're watching this. Just kidding. We missed you. And once again, Ellie Baker, who played Vivian Ward, is phenomenal in the show and just couldn't connect with us. Lord knows she tried. And Chase Wolfe playing Edward Lewis, man. The show is Pretty Woman, the musical. Absolutely fabulous. Can't wait to see you in it. It is at the CIBC Theater. I'll always call it the Schubert. That's me. March 12th through the 17th. And you can get tickets at BroadwayInChicago.com. Oh, we didn't give a shout out to Garry Marshall, who wrote the book of this thing for the movie. So
Absolutely. There's
a brilliant mind. Wanted to make sure we mentioned him. So break legs, Chase. Love the city. Spend time. Any questions, you just let me know, and I'll make sure you get all the good food you need.
Thank you very much, Paul. Appreciate it.
All right, BroadwayChicago.com are the tickets, March 12th to 17th. Pretty Woman, the musical. Do not miss it. Thanks for joining us.